Good morning, everyone. Glad to have you out this morning. Welcome to Shade Tree Community Church. Welcome to you here in person. Welcome to those that are online with us this morning. A couple of things that I want to give you information about. And if you did not get one of these outlines for the service on the way in, they're on the back table here. And these announcements are all listed here. First of all, again, thank you for those who continue to support the ministry, and there's continued ways to help. If you'd like to do so, there is our giving kiosk here. There's also online, if you go to our website, shadetreecc.org, there is a PayPal button there that you can use. There's also an address in here if you'd like to send in a donation. Our treasurer, Mark Bowes, his address is in here. So a couple of things that I want to tell you about. We are next Sunday going to celebrate our 5-year anniversary as a church. Some of you are new here today. We began our church 5 years ago in a funeral home, and it was there that we launched this ministry. And next week, I'm going to kind of review a little bit about our history, how we got started, why we started the church, and so forth. And what we are doing is reaching out to people with the assurance that this is a safe place to explore your faith. It is a safe place to ask questions and to even doubt. It is also an open and affirming congregation, regardless of individual sexual identity or orientation. And so we come together each week to be a safe place to explore the faith that we walk in, to try to answer the mysteries of life, and then to accept the mysteries that we can't figure out. And so I hope you'll come next week. We'll celebrate our 5-year anniversary with a rehearsal of our history a little bit. And then following that, we are going to have a lunch right after the service here. It's going to be catered by Barrio down here in downtown Willoughby. So if you like Barrio, stick around. There's no cost at all. There's the opportunity just to get to know some people maybe that you don't know, as well as enjoy some great food. Next week also, you're going to see a truck out in the parking lot, and it is the donation truck for the McKinley Community Outreach Center up in North Willoughby. McKinley has been helping individuals and families in the community for about 8 years now, and they distribute all kinds of taxable items. At one time before COVID hit, they were distributing food. They were also having individuals in for meals, that type of thing. They're slowly starting to open up a little bit, but what they need most are taxable items. And in your worship guide here, there's a listing of 12 things that we are looking at. It's at the very back. If you would like to buy some of those items and bring them in, we're going to put them in the back of the truck, and they will be donated to McKinley. Remember, we did this last year. It was during the summer that we did a Stuff the Truck event, and we had a lot of great donations, and it really helped them out for a number of months for the items that were donated. So if you'd like to participate in that, it's a great way to reach out to our community, to be a part of loving on our neighbors. Jesus said, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Now, there's also in, let me back up a second before I move on to the next thing. If you are coming to the lunch and have not signed up on the sign-up sheet back on the table there, would you please do so so I have an accurate count of how many people are going to be here for the lunch? Appreciate that. So, as part of our ministry as well, we are closely associated with our youth pastor, Corey Fetzer's wife's ministry, Anchor Counseling, out in Menor. They meet out in the Matchworks building. They have a great practice that's going on out there. Jenny Fetzer, you'll see in just a moment, she's doing the kids video. She also put together for us a short video for an opportunity. If you like to walk on Saturday, this coming Saturday, October the 9th, there's a walk to raise some additional funds for the NAMI, organization, NAMI, which means National Alliance on Mental Illness, which is a free resource to individuals that need that kind of help in the community. If you like to walk, this might be a great thing to do. I think it's starting out at the Mentor Civic Center is the start of the walk next this coming Saturday. There is, in your worship guide here, a website, namiwalks.org, with a participant slash, as well as Janet Fetzer. But let me show you that video at this time. Participate, you can get a hold of Jenny and ask questions if you have any. Then also, I want to introduce the kids ministry. As you know, we are currently suspended from our kids ministry as far as classroom. We have not started that back up since we came back in person. But Jenny Fetzer, who you'll see on the screen, has been recording a weekly video lesson that we upload to YouTube. And so the kids can watch that on YouTube, but we get to watch it now. So I'm going to introduce Jenny in this week's Kids Ministry.
Hi, Shade Tree Kids. I hope things are going well for you. Things are pretty good over here. We're enjoying the fall, and we've been getting outside a lot, spending time doing school. I hope you're doing the same. This week, we're going to talk about a really, really special individual in our history, and I hope that after we do the lesson today, that you're able to read a little bit more about her with your grown-ups. But let's start first with our affirmation for the week. Our affirmation is, I find within myself the power to do what's right, which is a pretty powerful thought, that there are things within us that help us make the right decisions. That's kind of like a superpower. Okay, so there's a quote from Harriet Tubman that says, every great dream begins with a dreamer. Always remember, you have within you the strength, the patience, and the passion to reach for the stars and change the world. Here we go. In the year 1820, almost all Black people in the United States were enslaved. Enslaved people had no rights. They were owned by another person and had no choices about their lives. Harriet Tubman was born to parents who were enslaved, and that meant Harriet was an enslaved person too. Harriet's mother and father could not protect her from the cruelties of slavery, and she was forced to work hard from a very young age. She took care of babies and did work in the master's house and out in the fields. Even as a little child, she was sent out in the winter to check muskrat traps. Muskrats are large rodents that live in underwater dens and were trapped for their fur. So she had to walk waist deep into freezing cold water to retrieve the dead muskrats. Can you imagine? Although she never learned to read or write, she was smart and was always listening, watching, and learning. She was never an enslaved person in her heart and never accepted that she was unworthy because she was Black or because she was a girl. She learned to pad herself with extra clothing for protection during frequent beatings. That means that sometimes her masters would hurt her. When Harriet was about 11 years old, she boldly refused an order from a white man to help stop his runaway slave. Instead, she stood back and let the enslaved man run by her. The man angrily threw a heavy metal weight after the runaway, and it hit Harriet in the head. The weight broke Harriet's skull and almost killed her. Unfortunately, this kind of cruelty to enslaved people was not uncommon, and Harriet wasn't even given medical care. She wasn't even allowed to see a doctor. She recovered, but she suffered for the rest of her life with pain, seizures, and blackouts because of what happened. She couldn't read, but she was told stories from the Bible, and Harriet had a deep inner life of prayer. She liked to pray a lot. She always tried to follow the guidance she felt from God, and everyone who knew her said she showed amazing inner strength and appeared to be fearless. After years of struggle and thinking about being free, she heard she was to be sold and taken further south where freedom would be impossible to find. She prayed and planned an escape. She took two of her brothers with her, but her brothers turned back. It was too frightening to be out in the dark woods, possibly getting lost, shot, or captured. Harriet didn't want to give up, but she went back with them. Then Harriet prayed and planned again. She wouldn't let anything stop her. The second time she went alone, traveling almost 100 miles to Pennsylvania, where enslaved people were free. She could have stayed in Pennsylvania and had a safe life, but Harriet felt she had to help others escape out of slavery. So instead of staying, she went back to the South and led others to freedom. She could have been caught or killed or sold or taken far away, but she went anyway. Harriet made 19 dangerous trips to the South and brought many of her family and friends and even strangers to a new life where they were no longer enslaved. Harriet used all her courage and willpower to make the trips. There were rewards given to people who turned in runaway enslaved people, and anyone willing to help had to do it in secret. The people in secret places that were used to get slaves to freedom were called the Underground Railroad, and Harriet was called a conductor. Harriet often disguised herself as a man or an old person so she and her passengers wouldn't be caught. She gave babies medicine so they would sleep and not cry while they were hiding. If anyone wanted to give up and go back, she refused to let them go. An enslaved person who went back would be beaten or killed and forced to give away secret information that would endanger others. Every trip was a double risk for Harriet because she had to travel to the people who wanted to help and then travel back to the North with them. There were many angry slave owners who would have killed her for what she was doing, but she never gave up and never lost one passenger. Her most important trip was going back to her former home and getting her parents to come live with her. They lived the rest of their lives in Canada, where they knew freedom. Harriet was a small, uneducated Black woman who lived during a time when Black people could be bought and sold, and women of any race had very few rights. She had a lifelong, debilitating illness that would have kept most people from even leaving their home. She was always poor and had to work hard every day just to survive. But still, during Harriet's long life of 93 years, she proved that by applying willpower in the right direction with determination and an open heart, there are unlimited possibilities. Her determination to do what's right and to help others was an inspiration to enslaved people and those who were free, to women and men, to those in the North and South, to people of every race and color and gender, and to generations who came after her. Isn't that such an amazing story? And the neatest part about it is that it's true. That really happened. Harriet Tubman was a real person who helped save all of those enslaved people. So I have a couple questions for you. Do you know anything about enslaved people getting their freedom? Have you learned about that in school? Have you ever tried to walk through the woods at night without a flashlight? How do you think it felt to Harriet and the enslaved people to travel in the dark while people were hunting them? That would feel so scary. They had to have been so brave. Do you know anyone whose character traits like Harriet Tubman? How are they like her? Maybe they're brave. Maybe they help other people. Maybe they stand up for what's right. Could you be like that? Have you ever stood up against someone who is being cruel to another person, an animal? Were you scared? So Harriet Tubman is a wonderful example of a person who fought for what she believed in and saved many people because of that. So I want us to think about different ways that we can do that this week, okay? So talk to the adults around you and your friends and your teachers and all the people around you to try and see different ways that you can help people. Okay, friends, we hope to see you soon and we hope you have a wonderful week. Bye.
I learn as much from those videos as the kids. So that's a That was great. Thank you, Jenny. So as we come to our time of worship this morning, I want to read Psalm 133. It's very short, but it ties in to the subject matter that we're going to talk about for a few moments. Psalm 133, it says, "How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron running down over the collar of his robe. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore." So there's this idea of unity and acceptance, and this idea of when you find individuals of kindred spirit, there is an anointing, because it gives to you strength, it gives to you energy, and it gives to you hope. Love is the life that responds to a call and chooses its truth as its treasure and walks with one who says, "Come and follow me, for to show you the way is my pleasure." You are looking at true community when it circles its resources to nurture, protect, and cover people, some of who are struggling and some who need encouragement. None of us live our life alone. We live it in relationship to other people. And so the song that Corey is going to sing is going to remind us that we are knit together.
You.
Thanks, Corey. When we think about the life of Jesus, and we think about him coming toward the end of his life, it's an interesting question, what was on his mind? We know that there was some anxiety. He is praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's facing death on the cross, and he is praying to God, and he's asking God if there's any other way to accomplish what the Father wanted him to accomplish. But there's another prayer that Jesus prays, and the prayer is in regard to those that will carry his message into the world. And this prayer is found in John chapter 17, and it's a fairly lengthy passage. Inside your worship guide, you'll find John 17, verses 6 through 22. And I want you to note what Jesus is praying for as he looks toward his own life coming to an end. He's not so much praying about himself, but he's praying for those that will follow him. He says, "I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I'm asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours." Notice how many times he says, these individuals, these brothers, these sisters, these followers belong to you, God. They're part of your family. He says, "All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I'm coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I sanctify myself so that they also may be sanctified in the truth. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word." That's you. That's me. "That they may all be one." He prays for unity again. "As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one." So like three or four times in this prayer, he keeps praying for oneness among his people. That might be a good way for us to pray as well. Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, and we recognize this high priestly prayer of Jesus is a prayer for love, acceptance, oneness, unity. We live in such a divided world, Father. We don't see our common humanity. We don't see each other as our brothers and sisters. Many times we see the other as an enemy or a potential threat. But Jesus tells us to love our neighbor as ourselves. He tells us that we are of kindred spirit and that we belong to one another and we should care for each other. Lord, we come before you today and we thank you for the opportunity to not only open your word, but to come around the Lord's table, that wonderful sacrament that is given as a way of remembrance that we are a part of your family. We're so thankful for the promise that nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we do pray for oneness, not only among our own church here, but among the body of Christ and beyond. We pray, Father, that we might love each other, that we might know and be known and love and be loved and serve and be served and celebrate and be celebrated. We pray, Lord, that you'll give to us the energy to keep going in this ongoing work until you bring us to yourself. So thank you, Father, that you bring us around the table of grace and give to us these moments to remember who we are, who we can continue to be. We pray all this. Jesus. We have yet to see the long-term effects of the prolonged experience of social isolation that we have experienced over the last 18 months. I think we feel the consequence of it, and I think all of us long for life to get back to normal, right? Where we're just having the freedom to go where we want to go and do what we want to do. And what we find is that we keep kind of needing to stretch it out another month and another month, and that gets quite frustrating. It seems as though what we have turned to in the meantime is connection through social media. I want to talk a little bit today about staying socially connected, because for many people, the COVID-19 pandemic has disrupted social life, preventing or restricting in-person time with our friends and time with our families. And as more people get vaccinated, obviously, hopefully the risk of serious illness goes down. Now, when variants begin to be factored into the equation, we wonder, again, how long is it going to take for it to be safe? Well, some people, once they are comfortable, will gladly and easily even resume their former social lives, and hopefully they have even a greater appreciation of their friendship circles. For other people, the habits of social isolation are hard to change, and sometimes there is the fear, maybe, of moving ahead. Friendships and supportive relationships are essential to our well-being, and I don't know if we have yet seen what the long-term effects of the last 18 months are going to be upon us psychologically and emotionally, and even spiritually, for that matter. But what we've been trying to do is stay connected. And yet there are certain limitations of connection when you're only doing it on social media. So we want to understand the importance of seeing each other face to face and talking to each other over the table. And we want to continue to pursue a life well lived, a life that is filled with hope, joy, and peace. And so we started a series a couple of weeks ago called Buried Treasure. And this buried treasure that we are in search of is built upon a lesson taught to us by Jesus in one of his parables in Matthew chapter 13. But let's review for a moment. We talked a little bit about seeking first the kingdom of God, seeking the buried treasure that's available for all of us if we search it out. And then last week, we talked a little bit about savoring the opportunities that we have to connect, to be able to experience love, joy, and peace. And today, what I want to do is talk a little bit about staying socially connected. And all of these things are built upon teasing out this parable that Jesus gave to us. And we are using a little bit of imagination here, because that's what you need to do with parables sometimes. You need to kind of imagine what the connections are. Here's the parable again. It's found in Matthew 13, verses 43 and 44. And Jesus is saying, "Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear." And here's the parable. "The kingdom of heaven," or the kingdom of God, "is like a treasure that is hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and in his joy he went and sold all he had and bought that field." So what is this buried treasure that a man would take such a risk to sell all of his possessions so that he could buy this field, so that he could obtain this treasure? Well, Jesus never really tells us. He never really tells us, other than this is somehow connected to the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, which is more than some external political arrangement. Jesus tells us that the kingdom of God is something on the inside as well. It's something that we connect with inside. So when we are able to connect inside, it's supposed to bring us joy. And it seems as though this is kind of an open-ended quest that we are on, to continually to find happiness on the inside. many times people equate happiness with good external circumstances. And I don't know about you, even when life is going well, there just are times, even in the course of a good week, where circumstances aren't exactly what we want them to be. And so if we're seeking happiness and joy and peace by arranging our external circumstances so it's perfect, well, believe me, we're never, ever going to reach it. But if we understand that the kingdom of God is not meat and drink and external circumstances, but it is righteousness and peace and joy through the Holy Spirit that is given to us, then we can look for that treasure that is hidden in the field. Now, here's a question that comes to my mind. I wonder if this individual that is on an all-out search for the treasure in the field, I wonder if he had some help. How big is this field? How long would it take him to search this field? Does he need some help and hints along the way to understand where to look for this buried treasure? All of that is related to community. Maybe there's someone that told him about the treasure. Maybe there was someone that says, hey, when you go to look for this treasure, I'll help you. Now, last week we talked a little bit about an episode in the life of Jesus where he heals 10 individuals that had leprosy. And these individuals had their own kind of social connection. It was limited, though, because in the ancient world, in Judaism, lepers were outcasts. They weren't permitted in the community. So they had to form kind of their own community, and it was there that they found acceptance among one another. However, Jesus comes along by way of reminder, and he heals these 10 lepers, and he says to the lepers, go show yourself to the priest. Why did he say that? Well, once these lepers went and showed themselves to the priest, they could be cleared of their leprosy, and they could rejoin their community. But there was one of the lepers that was a Samaritan. He wasn't a Jew. And so these 9 go show themselves to the priest. They are healed of their leprosy. The priest will clear them so that they can rejoin their family. But this Samaritan, who is a double outcast, he is physically an outcast because he's a leper, but he's socially an outcast as well, turns around and goes back to Jesus, and he says thank you to Jesus. And it is there we see that he has the opportunity to connect again, but who is he going to connect with? Maybe he's lived a long time with these other 9 Jewish lepers. Is he going to be accepted socially if he goes to their community? Or will he have to seek out a new community? And if he does, who is it that will accept him into their community and love them and love him? Well, throughout history, people have lived together in groups, we all know that, where they have found protection and help and support, a common identity, and a shared knowledge. But sometimes circumstances can change that connection. So here we are 18 months later in a pandemic, and we've only been connected through social media, and sometimes people move on to other relationships. Sometimes you lose connection with people that you used to work with or you saw all the time in person. And so to one extent or another, it's a real challenge to re-enter into a community, isn't it? Sometimes we feel, oh, that group has changed or I have changed. Do I fit anymore? Basically, I'm telling you the story of high school, right? Well, that has all kinds of groups. Am I in or am I out? Am I accepted or am I rejected? But we are built for community. We're wired that way. And one of the things in the prayer that Jesus prayed that I just read is that he was in constant communion with God. And then he prays that we would be in constant communion with God and with one another. Richard Rohr, an author, wrote this, I quote, If the Trinity reveals that God is relationship itself, then the goal of the spiritual journey is to discover and move toward connectedness on ever new levels. The contemplative mind enjoys union on all levels. We may begin by making a little connection with other people and with nature and animals, then grow in deeper connectedness with people. Finally, we can experience full connectedness as union with God. Remember, how you do anything is how you do everything. Without connectedness and communion, we don't exist fully as our truest selves. Becoming who we really are is a matter of learning how to become more and more deeply connected. No one can possibly go to heaven alone, or it would not be heaven. So Richard Rohr makes a good point. God exists in community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He creates us in His image. We are created for community. We are created for connection. And maybe one element, maybe one part of this buried treasure that we are seeking is the boundless joy that comes from social connection. Online and in-person connections are not the same thing. It's easy to be online and to create a persona that is not the true self. There are even shows that are built on this, people who have put forth a false persona. How many have ever watched Catfish? You know, it's one of those things where, is that the true person that's emailing me, that's texting me? You know, even face-to-face, it's often difficult to know each other at in depth. So sometimes what will happen is we'll withdraw into safe circles. Why is that? Maybe we feel most comfortable or socially connected with people that are just like us. In other words, unity in community is often based on similar social patterns, economic status, or common interests, or maybe even common enemies. And so community is often built around some of these things rather than built upon accepting each other for who we really are, loving each other for who we really are, and being understanding that God has not made any of us exactly the same. All of us are different. We all have different gifts. We all have different experiences and circumstances. And so there's a problem that has arisen, I think, anyways, in the last 20 to 25 years, where we live in a unique time where it's easy to think that we are socially connected because we have more knowledge about people. And we ask for friendship on Facebook, don't we? And they accept our friendship request. And all of a sudden, I have 500 friends? I have 1,200 friends? Well, that's what it says. These are my friends online. But in reality, I can't handle that many close relationships. Can you? None of us can. Although I've done a number of weddings where I think they had their whole friendship circle in the wedding party. But, in other words, those are acquaintances that we have. And within those acquaintances, we have the opportunity to kind of peek into their lives a little bit as they post pictures of what's going on in their life, maybe some significant milestones, a wedding, a birthday, whatever it may be. But it is also true that in the social media world, I'm kind of vulnerable. I'm vulnerable to what is being presented to me as true, but it's not necessarily true. Sometimes misinformation or even misdirection can come through social media. And we think we know something, but we really don't. You know, sometimes there's just no social connection whatsoever. Facebook and other social media creates the illusion of social connection sometimes. You know, there's a book, it's 20 years old now, in fact, called Bowling Alone by Robert Putnam. It was written back in 2001. And he observed even 20 years ago that common activities that we used to enjoy with friends has gone down tremendously. In other words, where have the bowling leagues gone, right? Where have some of these other social activities gone? John Ortberg, in his book called Soul Keeping, examines what it means to have a healthy soul. And he talks about people being transient. In fact, it's an amazing thing. Us pastors take note of this. Probably individuals in church don't notice it as much. But it is true that every 5 years, a church loses half of its membership, or half of its attendance. And if it's not then replenished, obviously it goes down in number. But you think about people that have passed away or moved away, or they have walked away from a church. Every 5 years, there's about a 50% turnover. So that's part of what it means to live in this transient world. People are on the move more often now than in previous generations. So according to renowned psychologist Martin Seligman, he says, this has resulted in the meaning of life being narrowed down to the self. In other words, if the people around me are always changing, it's hard to find purpose in relationships. I have to find it within myself. And Ortberg also believes that we as individuals are way too small a unit to bear the weight of life alone. So the demise of social connectedness is seen in the demise of social groups that once thrived. Think about it, church, fraternal organizations, special interest groups like bowling leagues or bingo nights. Most of the groups, the VFW, the Masons, the Rotary Clubs, are struggling today to stay in existence. And part of that is the era in which we live. People have their own connections. They do their own things. They go their own way. But what we find is that we still need deep social connections. And whether it's in church or someplace else, what we really need to understand is that there is unity in community when we understand that we are part of God's family, we're a part of His created purpose, and we treat each other as such. Have you ever noticed in social media how nasty people are? They probably wouldn't say some of the things they say to you, to your face. They would probably back off of that. But on social media, all guardrails are down, right? Well, you know what that means? It means sometimes social media is not a safe place because we can be attacked for something that we believe. And yet, we cannot live without community. We're created for it. But however, the kind of community that we seek can either be life-giving or it can be destructive, and we have to be careful of that. There was an episode in the life of Jesus, and it's fairly lengthy, but I think it's important to understand. In the chapter prior to this parable, in Matthew chapter 12, Jesus is going about doing good, and he's healing individuals, and there was this one occasion where there was this demon-possessed man that was brought to Jesus. He was also blind, and he was mute, and Jesus, in his power, heals that man. And the individual is restored to health. He can talk and he can see. And all the people are astonished. And they begin to ask the question, could this be the Messiah? Could this be the Savior? Well, the Pharisees are threatened by that. And so they come up with this statement that this miracle that Jesus has just performed is being done by the power of Satan. So Jesus turns and he tells the Pharisees, he says, every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. If Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand? In other words, he says, where there is a division of community, destruction is not far behind. That should threaten us to a certain extent, because if we are divided as a nation, we're fooling ourselves if we think it won't have destructive results. So it's important to understand, as Jesus tells these individuals, that there's no way that a house divided is able to stand. Now, that is his answer to their accusation. But, and this is a long passage, and we're not going to get into it today. But my main point is, when we get into a divisive community, watch how it affects us emotionally, socially, psychologically. It has an effect. But there is a better way. And in the high priestly prayer of Jesus that we just looked at, his prayer, three or four times in that prayer, is for our oneness. Now, by oneness, he's not talking about uniformity. He's talking about unity. You're different than I am. I'm different than you are. We're different ages. We grew up in different places. We have different circumstances, and we had different experiences. None of us are the same. But you know what we have in common? The love of God. The love of God that resides within us. And when we build our unity around God's love for us, then what we can do is be devoted to one another. So one last passage before I close. So this is the early part of the church. It's just getting started. And in Acts chapter 2, we read these words of what the church was like. It was not a perfect community. Many times in Christian circles, they think if we could just get back to the first century, you know, all our problems would be solved. No, all you got to do is read to Acts chapter 6, and you'll see that they were divided. They had their own problems. But this is a perfect portrait of what they were devoted to. Listen, it says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer, and everyone was filled with awe. And many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together, and they had everything in common. And selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. And every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes. They ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being Couple of things important in that paragraph. First of all, they were a community that was built on nurturing relationships. They were willing to help each other out. And secondly, this community committed themselves to doing what was necessary to meet each other's needs. Now, in this case, there were some financial needs that there were individuals that had problems and they needed help, and they were willing to do that. But I think on the whole, they were devoted to the idea of mutually nurturing relationships. And that's what we should strive for, not only as our local church, but we should pray for when we think about the church at large and what Christ is desiring us to do. I think we are at a point in the history of our country where it's hard to stay socially connected in diversity without becoming destructive in the process. Maybe our best chance to survive and thrive as a nation is not to reject our diversity, but to embrace it. Maybe our best chance to survive as a human race is to realize that life is a gift, love is the point, and we must each day choose to be a beneficial presence in our world. Maybe our best chance to survive to be a small example of people who embrace our differences, because we are all a part of this invisible kingdom where joy and laughter and love are normative. Maybe one way we can do this is by uniting around the person of Jesus. So in these challenging and tough times that we live in, we are discovering as a wisdom that we needed all along, that we are connected. And the healthier our social connections, the better our world can become. So what are some of the ways that we can connect? Well, on the night Jesus was betrayed by one man, Judas, who didn't like the way things were set up, and he sells Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver, Jesus takes a common thing, bread and a cup, and he holds it up and he says, "This is my body given for you. This is the cup of the new covenant, a new way of living, a new way of socializing, a new way of connection. Drink it in remembrance." So up front here, I have the cup and some wafers. They are gluten-free. If you would like to take communion, I ask that you come up, take a piece of bread, take the cup back to your seat, hold it. We will eat together as a community. So do not feel pressure if this is new to you, if communion is not something that you've done before and you don't feel comfortable, that's fine too. There's no judgment, no judgment. But if you'd like to, come on up, take the elements, go back to your seat, and then we will take the bread. So Jesus is with his disciples around the table, and he knows that his death is a few hours away. So he prays that prayer for oneness. Then he takes a piece of bread and breaks it. And he says, "This is my body that's broken for you." And what we find is in the breaking of the bread, there's this understanding that sometimes to bring reconciliation, harmony, to be brought back into a whole relationship, first with God and other, sometimes there's a brokenness that needs to be mended. When Jesus breaks the bread, he is symbolizing what is happening on the cross. He's taking our brokenness. He's taking our darkness. He's taking our shortcomings, and he's saying, "God loves you anyway." Yeah, we've all sinned and fall short of the glory. God loves us. Yeah, I'll make a mistake before the day is done. God loves me. Jesus takes our sin, takes our heartache, takes our brokenness, symbolized in the brokenness. He says, "I want you to remember." So together, brothers and sisters, we take this. We are reminded. We eat together in hope. The Old Testament is built upon an old covenant, which was built on a lot of do's and don'ts, called the Mosaic Law. People fell short of it all the time. And some of them actually began to misuse it at times, manipulate circumstances, take advantage of it. Jesus, around the table, takes a cup of wine. And during the Passover feast, which is one of those feasts that the Jews celebrated on an annual basis, he took the third cup that is in the Passover celebration. And he holds it up. Says, "This is a new covenant in my blood. There's a new way of living. There's a new way of connecting. There's a new way of relationship." And he takes his blood that is poured out on the cross as a way of paying for all the heartache, and all the hatred that mankind has toward God and toward each other. Because this is the new covenant. This is the new way. Drink. So we drink together in the hope that we can be a better people, bringing about God's kingdom. Let's pray. So as we come to a close today in our service, I want you to stand with me for a moment. I mentioned earlier at the beginning of the service that you are looking at true communion. community when it circles its resources to nurture, protect, and cover people who are struggling. That's not just financially, that can be emotional. So here's a prayer I'd like to close with. And if you see it up on the screen, you can read along there. Lord, as you have taught us, we bow down before you in all humility, gentleness, and patience, supporting each other with love and trying to keep the unity of the Spirit by the bonds of peace, that we may be socially connected in unity amid our diversity. With one voice, we repent of our divisions and devote ourselves to working together for reconciliation, peace, and justice. We stand together in imploring your help to live as your disciples, overcoming selfishness, arrogance, hatred, and violence. Give to us the strength to give. Inspire us that we might foster a culture of dialogue and not deceit. Make us instruments of your peace so that we may be a community that increases joy and happiness together. All God's people. Thanks for being here. Thanks for being online. I trust God will bless you today and on into this week. Peace and shalom.